My name is Douglas Bader, and I'm delighted to be here on this occasion. This is 25 years after the Battle of Britain was fought, and I'm standing on this, if one might say, historic, if not holy, ground of Biggin Hill.
I say, you never forget her, Bob. And I remember this when I sit in this cockpit and look at instruments and so on. I mean, one's back home again, you know. I could fly this thing if you take the hangar down and start it, you know, without any trouble. They were a lovely aeroplane. They still look about the prettiest thing that's ever been built. I mean, jets included. And you see, that wonderful chap, Mitchell, who designed this aeroplane, I think it was awfully sad that he didn't live to see what it did for his country, because apart from the superlative design, it has been and always was marvelously built. If you're always flying an aeroplane where not only bullets from the enemy are going to destroy you, but if you aren't careful, the wing will fold up, I think it makes a great deal of difference to morale, you know. Well, as far as the armament of these two aeroplanes are concerned, on the Spitfire we had, to start with, 8 guns, which were 4 aside, 8 machine guns doing about 1,000 rounds a minute each, which is 8,000 rounds a minute that you're letting go with. Now, on the Messerschmitt, Bob will tell you, they had a cannon straight down the middle.
Yeah, on the Messerschmitt here, I think it was very, very good armor, personally. They had a heavy cannon firing directly through the prop boss, which is the center of the axis of the aircraft. And that was very effective armament. It was dead central in the aircraft. Then they had 2 heavy machine guns along the top of the fuselage here, there and there, which fired through the propeller. And 2 other machine guns, normal machine guns, outside of the circuit of the propeller, which was very good armament, I think. Don't you, Douglas?
Yes, I think it was. I think they must have hit the prop sometimes with the synchro.
Well, I think they knocked lumps out.
Because, I mean, you know, you did get knocks out of the propeller.
Now, I'm a German pilot here, flying on Messerschmitt 109. This one has Richthofen's markings on it. But if I saw an attack from a Hurricane or a Spitfire developing behind me, due to the engine that I got, which had direct fuel injection, it wasn't worried of negative G. So my immediate evasive action would be just to stick my nose straight down as fast as I could and accelerate away.
And you see, I'm behind him about to shoot him down, and he does that. Now, I've got an ordinary carburetor in this Spitfire. So when I push the stick forward, all the petrol flow goes away from the carburetor, and the airplane goes
pop bang,
all this sort of banging and so on, and things come out from the bottom of the cockpit, you know, the spanners, the people left on the floor and so on, and dust and stuff. So that is no good. Now, what we evolved was somehow we got to keep the gravy in the carburetor, you know, and so we used to do a half roll like that to keep the negative G, which meant you were going down with your back to him, and then roll round and hope
that you were in behind
that him. You could see him. Now, usually, of course, he was way apart, running like a lamplighter, you know, you couldn't get him. But we did discover, and Bob says that if you saw him and stayed behind him, although you weren't anywhere near him, that he pulled out of the dive rather early, and then you could do that across him, get behind him again,
cut the corner.
This was the point. The reason was that a very famous German pilot had pulled the wings off a 109, pulling out for speed or pulling out too hard, and we reckoned that this had gone round the German Air Force, and they'd been told to be pretty sort of porky with pulling the lever back, you know, when they were going very fast. And it made a tremendous difference, although our maneuver looks complicated. I mean, Bob will agree with me, actually after a bit you got frightfully good at it, you know, so that you could nip around, and he was still there but a bit further away.
Well, now, I'm the Messerschmitt here, coming down, and I'm attacking the Spitfire. Now, the Spitfire has a remarkably good rate of turn, better than the Messerschmitt. Now, as they're turning steeply, the Messerschmitt, to shoot at the Spitfire, has got to really aim there, ahead of the Spitfire, because it's turning fast, what we call a deflection shot. But the Messerschmitt can't turn as quickly as the Spitfire, so therefore, all his shots are going astern here.
Somebody saw the enemy and alerted you on the RT, and they seemed a long way away and quite small. Now, when you got a bit smarter, you didn't rush to overtake him, because you found that the little dot or the aeroplane, it suddenly came straight at you like that because you're going much too fast. You had no chance of shooting. You overshot people like Bob Stanford Tuckhead, a bloody good judgment, you know, and one or two of the rest of us. And you didn't rush it. And the ideal way to shoot another aeroplane down is to be going at the same speed 200 yards behind them. In other words, you had maximum time. There was no hurry. And that was the secret, not to be in a hurry. Most of us, it was purely the aeroplane we wanted to get rid of. We didn't care a bit whether the chap inside he got out or whether he was killed. We disliked the iron crosses and the crooked sign of the swastika. And anyhow, who the hell were these chaps to come over into our sky and drop bombs on us, on our people? That was the feeling. There was no personal antipathy. I don't think one really thought about a pilot inside it. Now, if you're flying an aeroplane, you're very much on the ball, you're alert, and then you discover that there's a whole string of bullets come in from the back of the cockpit, which actually happened to me once. Now, there's nothing you can do about it, that. But physically, you're doing something to get out of the way of this stream of stuff that's coming in behind you. So you're on the job, so to speak. Now, I don't believe you can be frightened and active at the same time. Not in that particular context. And I suppose other people may have had a different sort of fears, you know, but I can't think of anyone who was frightened actually in the aeroplane flying along to the battle or seeing the battle about to start. It's only when something physical happens to you that you get this feeling, and I can only describe it as a hand touching my heart, which, you know, like, if that's fair, well, then I was frightened.